Yes, sir.
Good evening to one and all. Of course, it is an afternoon, but maybe some of you are still in the evening stage. So we are entering into the session three. The session three is about IoT protocols, basically the protocols used for our IoT applications. So today we have with us Professor Atul Negi. So let me introduce Professor Atul Negi to all. Dr. Atul Negi is a professor at School of Computer and Information Sciences, University of Hyderabad, and previously, sir has worked as a director at PS Indore, India. He has authored more than 100 publications in peer-reviewed conferences and journals. He has co-edited conference proceedings volumes from Springer IEEE as program chair, and he has served in technical program committees for several international conferences. He is a technical committee member of IEEE SMC and Soft Computing Division. He has served as a chair of the IEEE Computer Society and IEEE Computational Intelligence Society chapters at IEEE Hyderabad section. He also served as chairman of IEEE Hyderabad section during the year 2012-13. He is also a member of IAPR through the Indian unit of IAPR. He is an associate editor for Springer Nature Computer Science since January 2021. He is a reviewer for various IEEE transactions and international journals like pattern recognition, information sciences, neurocomputing, and so on and so forth. He has worked as a co-investigator on the Indian Language Resource Center, that is basically on the Telugu. It is a sponsored research project from Department of Information Technology, Government of India, and is a principal investigator for the Robust OCR project from the Department of Information Technology. He is also a co-investigator with the projects from ISRO, MHA, and other project agencies. He has successfully guided 11 doctoral dissertations while mentoring several others. And the awards, he is a fellow of IETE and was a speaker for the KK Nair Memorial Lecture of IETE. He was awarded the IEEE Region 10 Outstanding Volunteer Award in 2020. So there's a brief introduction about our Professor Atul Negi, sir. So, sir, the session is now on towards you. Please carry on, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I thank Dr. Nagendra Kumar. He has organized this total program, the Atul FDP program on IoT. And I'm happy that I have an opportunity to speak in this program. And I'm happy to see that the number of participants is also pretty great. Okay, so of course, a slight problem is that this is a post-lunch session. So anyway, we will all try to cope up with that. Okay, and I hope what I will be showing you will be interesting enough and people will be enjoying that. So, okay, let me then go on. So I think today morning we had seen a really very nice journey into the IoT world, the devices and all these kind of things. Okay, so I don't have to speak much on that here, but just I wanted to show these images to say that in what way in the public opinion and mind the IoT world is coming up, you know. So like if you see one corner, it is smart shoes, other is smart toothbrush. All right, so these are actually fitness trackers. This is at a kid finder and the child monitor. These things are, you know, like at a individual and personal level. Personal level like health monitoring, then at consumer or industry level, smart shelves, things like that in this left picture. Okay, and the right picture is through icons. Through icons, it is trying to show the entire world of transportations and other industrial things to be connected. Okay, so this is iconically trying to show that, you know, how it is worldwide network of the interconnected objects. All right, some people wanted to know that why it is called things, but if you say objects also, that is also all right. And we are saying that semantically, we are having that each of these objects would be addressable. and they have to be addressable based on the standard communication protocols. Okay, so why is there stress on the standard communication protocols? The reason is that what is the opposite of standard? The opposite of standard is proprietary. Okay, so if it is proprietary, then it becomes a vendor specific thing. All right, and then there is no guarantee that there is interoperability. Okay, so I wish to stress the fact that it is the standard communication protocols which is leading to the interoperability, which should be given importance. So as it's FDP, I understand that a very large number of people are interested in research in this field and domain. Okay, so I'm just trying to show that, you know, what is a widespread span of all the IoT research activities. Okay, so here you can just have a glimpse of how widespread the IoT research activities are there. You can see in this figure, it is called as a taxonomy. So taxonomy means it's like a classification, and the various research fields are coded or are color coded. Okay, so I'll just briefly lead you through that. So those which are sensor related are here on the left. So the perception aspect in IoT, that is through the sensors. Okay, all the kinds of sensors are given here. So medical sensor, neural sensors, RFID, infrared, okay, mobile phone sensors, then all the instruments like magnetometers, right? Magnetometers is allowing you to get the direction north, south, okay, locations, camera, microphone, etc. All those are sensors. Then at the next level, we have the communication aspect. So near field communications, the RFID, wireless sensor network integrations, and things like that. Then we have the protocols wherein we have protocol stacks, etc. And it is that, you know, whether it is because constrained devices in IoT, so therefore the protocols are not expected to take much power. So low power kind of things are being stressed here. Then application protocols and the standards, say like ZigBee and things like that. Next, after the protocol, it then comes to the middleware. All right. So middleware is the software which is interfacing with the applications. All right. So then you have very many different kind of middleware which are database oriented, which are application specific, or they are service oriented and things like that. And then once we come to applications, there is huge number of applications all over. So leading from home automation, smart transport, energy conservation, smart agriculture, etc. Now, I'll show you another figure. Which is showing you an IoT ecosystem. All right. So this is also from a very good publication. That is Professor Raj Jain is a very famous professor in the field of networks. And with his student, so they have come up with a survey of protocols and standards for the Internet of Things. So I think this is a very encyclopedia and comprehensive research paper, and it is covering all the aspects. Okay, so please pay attention to this aspect, that the boxes, which are the red colored boxes. So it is giving you in a nutshell, like, you know, what all is the big scope of the IoT. So for example, you can say clouds are there, SDN, that is the software defined networks, all right, and applications, such kind of things for the data of the IoT which is being produced. So then we have the analytics, etc. Okay, and then this module here is the interconnection aspect. This is what we are going to be looking at. Okay, and so data acquisition aspect is already here. This marketing aspect is about the applications. Services is that how IoT services could be used in the various applications. And security and management aspects are spanning all the layers which are there with respect to the IoT. So this is the idea which you need to keep in mind. So I'm showing this and not simply jumping to the protocols, because I wanted to show you a context. Okay, we need to understand the context to see that what would be there. Okay, now here slightly more, we are getting more closer to the topic in the point. All right, so on the right hand side, that is, I'm just showing you the standard 7 layered architecture. Okay, so as anyone who has studied the computer networks domain, we know that there are the standard 7 layers which has been advocated. Okay, so starting from application, presentation, session, transport, network, data link, and physical layers. All right, and then we have that these layers are divided into two aspects. One is that is the physical media related layers and those which are related to the host and the processing on the hosts. Okay, so you can see here from this picture from Wikipedia that how the 7 layers are there. So when we talk about IoT protocols, this same standard 7 layer kind of aspects will be seen with respect to the IoT protocols. And as everyone knows that TCP/IP is the de facto application of the computer networking layers and the standard models. So you can see that in the left figure, that in the left table, that how the network layers are there, which are related to IoT. So under these network layers, basically you can see all the types of standards which are there. Okay, so 802.15.4. Okay, so basically Wi-Fi and Zigbee and those kind of things. Okay, so GSM and LTE. Okay, LPWAN kind of things are also there. So this we will not be taking this up. Whereas then at the IP layer level, we have the RPL, and which is the more thing for IoT. Okay, and 6LoWPAN, because it is the 6 is saying us that it is a IP version 6 kind of thing, but it has been adjusted for the low power issues. Okay, so that is at the internet layer level. At transport layer levels, you have the usual TCP UDP kind of transport layer. Okay, and then there is a DTLS like that, which is there. And at the top of that is where we are going to be talking about today. So that is, we are going to be talking about the application layer aspect of the IoT protocols. Okay, just a few of them I'm going to mention here. So COAP is one of them. MQTT is another. Okay, the web layer, that is the HTTP, is anyway there. And you have AMQP and so many others which are also there. Okay, so I will very strongly say that if someone is interested to go into advanced aspects, please look up this reference here, that is by Mishra and Katz, that is use of MQTT in M2M and IoT systems. Okay, it's a very wonderful publication, and I am planning to give a package to Dr. Nagendra Kumar, wherein all the papers which I have referenced, the PDFs of that, I will provide in a zip form. So it is there as an easy reference for anyone who wants to see them. Okay, next then. Now let's look at the IoT reference model. This is from another survey paper, and this is also a very good article. So this is where the edge cloud computing technologies for Internet of Things has been explained. Now this is trying to show this similar aspect. Only thing is that across the layers, what is taking place, and here the layer 3 and the edge or fog computing aspects are seen. Okay, so and the distinction is that when is the data moving? So data is moving when it is being communicated. Okay, and where it is being, it has been received at one of the processing or data points, and then that the other layers are for that aspect. Okay, so with this understanding of the overall ecosystem of the IoT layers and the protocols, we will get into the aspect related to the protocols. Okay, so as we know about protocols, we must also understand that what is the type of communications which is taking place in the protocols. So on the left, we have the broadly the three types of communications which are going to take place in for any IoT related communication. So we have a device to device communication. Okay, we have a device to server infrastructure communication. We have a server infrastructure sharing device data communication. Okay, so broadly all of them, they are corresponding to this model which is shown here. It is called as the request response communication model. Okay, so in the client server kind of model, what we have is that the client is one who is going to request some service to a server. Okay, the server will be the one who is going to fulfill that service request. Okay, so the request is arrived and it is receiving the request from various clients, and then it is going to take a look at that, what is the request, and related to the request there will be some resources which has to be delivered to the client. So the server is having the way, either locally or over the network, the server knows where to get the resources, and it will prepare a response and it will send back to the client. Okay, so this is the request response communication model, which is the basis for everything. Okay, and here the first example, that is device to device communications, you can see, for example, here. So I have a light switch and a light bulb. Okay, I have a home network wherein these are all on the same home network. Okay, so then the light switch is going to communicate to the light bulb saying that I have been switched off. My switching has taken place and you can be on now. So once the light bulb receives that information that it should be going on over the network, so then it will go on. Okay, so this is how the communications and the actions take place with the device to device communications. Okay, similarly, you can have device to server infrastructure communications. There are many different forms of the device to server infrastructure communications. And the server infrastructure sharing device data is that it can be at a server to server level communication. Okay, I will not be talking too much on the third aspect. Just to give you some idea, so you can try to see here. So the network we can have is two types of the network. One would be an internet, which is that you are going across different networks, and there is an internal network. Okay, so we can have that a server may be on an internal network as well. And this is just to show you and give you an example that you can have a Arduino device and that is configured with a web server working on that. Okay, and the depending upon the IP addresses and the routings, etc., which is available, it could be local, the local addresses, that is private IP addresses, or it could be public IP addresses. All right, so here in this example we are showing that there is a static public IP address which has been used to make this web server to be available over any other clients, etc., which are over the internet. Okay, and what is it that basically it could be that this Arduino device is relaying some temperature and other humidity and other such kind of information which could be useful for other nodes all over the internet. Okay, so this is just to give you some example that how the device and the server communication the data being published onto the internet is taking place. Okay, so just to get to that point, so like I mentioned earlier, we are now having the application level protocols. Okay, so we have application level protocols, that is say MQTT is there, which is the protocol for collecting the device data and which is being used to communicate it to the servers. And then we have XMPP, so which is a protocol which is best for connecting the devices to the people. This is a special case of the D2S pattern. Okay, as I mentioned to you earlier, D2S is the communication form which is from the devices to the servers. Okay, so XMPP is another type, and like the MQTT, which is a protocol for collecting the device data and connecting to the people. Okay, since people are there at the other end, which are then connected to the servers. Okay, similarly, now then we also have another kind of protocol, DDS, a fast bus for integrating the intelligent machines. And this is here, it is like, you know, a device to device kind of a protocol. Then you have AMQP, which is a queuing system, which is designed to connect the servers to each other. So like this, we can see that there are so many different types of the application level protocols, which could be used for connecting between the devices and the servers. Now, before we go on further, one very important concept which we have to understand, it is a very generic concept also, which is the way in which these protocols are set up. Okay, and this is called as the publish subscribe model. Okay, so as I had explained earlier, you have a client server kind of a model. Okay, now many times people don't understand that there has to be some kind of a whenever the connections are set up between clients and servers, some kind of synchronicity is involved. Okay, so I hope people know and understand that what the synchronicity would be meaning. Okay, synchronicity meaning that the moment a client is trying to contact a server, the server has to be up, and when the client message is received, then the server should act and send in a response, and then the client should receive that. Okay, however, there is a reason why this kind of synchronicity would not be expected in IoT devices. Okay, so what is the reason for that? The reason for that is that IoT devices are very much resource constrained, basically energy constrained. Okay, so it is not required that they will be on all the time. Okay, so IoT devices would not be on all the times. They may be you can say in a low power power conserving mode most of the time, and once in a while they will be waking up and they may be communicating and seeing that what they are having with respect to that. So then what will happen to the messages which they have to receive and they have to send? Okay, so that's why there is no way in which it may be that they are not able to send out across these messages directly to those who are consuming. Okay, so as they cannot send out the messages directly, they have to make use of an intermediary. All right, so the intermediary is called as a broker here. Okay, and as in the real life situations, what is it that a broker does? The broker is trying to find a setup, a connection between those who are giving out a resource and those who are intending to receive that resource. Okay, so that is the reason for the broker. Okay, but in the distributed systems terminology, this kind of broker concept is well known, and we have many different types of resource brokers. Okay, here I'm just showing you one kind of a simple way of understanding the publish subscribe model. Okay, what is the idea here? The idea here is that let us say that that there are bus schedules. Okay, we are talking about a smart city here. So there are, say, bus schedules, and different types of bus schedules are being produced, and they are coming because of the buses being in transit, and then their arrival and departure at various bus stops, etc., is being known, and then the schedule is being built up by one which is trying to build their scheduling. Okay, so then this would be a publisher, meaning it is the one who is sending out the data which is related to the bus schedules. At the other end, then we may have another publisher which is similarly doing something, but this is for, say, some metro train kind of schedules. Okay, so all these schedules are being published, and they are being published to the broker. Okay, so all these things are arriving to the broker. Now there are different consumers, and these consumers are interested in different types of information. Okay, so that but they know that they don't need to know which are the correct publishers. They don't need to know that. All they need to know is that they need to know that there is a broker. Okay, so if they know the broker, and then they tell the broker what type of information they are interested in, and then the broker will put them on some kind of a subscription list. Okay, so there, here, just for an example, what I am trying to show is that we have one set of subscribers who are interested only in the train schedules. Another set of subscriber is interested in both types of schedules, that is the train and bus schedules. Similarly, we may have yet another subscriber who is interested only in the bus schedules. Okay, so but anyway, they all don't need to know who are the publishers. They just need to know that there is a broker who is going to be able to supply that information which is there. Okay, I think this is a fairly easy and intuitive concept to understand. So the publish subscribe model is there. Okay, and I think you are appreciating that all the subscriber needs to know is that how to contact the broker, and through the broker they will be able to collect all the sorts of information which is required. Similarly, the publisher also doesn't need to know exactly who are the subscribers who are needing or they are going to use that information. They just need to know that who is the broker, and they will just supply their information to the broker, and they will be assured that this information will get across to the consumers who are actually needing. And the beauty of it is that everything can be done asynchronously, meaning asynchronous between the publisher and the subscriber. Okay, so this is how the overall perspective of the publish subscribe model is there. And this is very useful, and it is I can then just show you here that what are the benefits. Okay, so basically the benefit is that you have a simple architecture of the point-to-point links, which is there in the initial one, and it is replaced by, so the bidirectional links, which has to be between a publisher or in a sub, or a data source and data sink, that is replaced by a single connection to this message bus or broker. Okay, and then independently, if, let me just show you that once again. Independently, devices may be added to the publishing list. Independently, devices may be added to the subscription list. Okay, so it's very easy that to add and the delete the devices which is there. Okay, and the data could be published and it can be reused to extend the existing services. Okay, so whatever data is there, and it's, as long as the broker is able to buffer that data can be sent across to whichever consumers and all which is there. Okay, so the fourth point is the one which I had stressed already, that the publishers and the subscribers are decoupled in time, as they need not know each other, and they are also distributed in space. Okay, so therefore their operations and tasks are not disturbed or halted during the publishing and the receiving of the notifications. Okay, so now let's just have a quick overview of some of these protocols. I'm sure that Dr. Nagendra Kumar and the students team, they have planned some kind of experimentation and all with this, but not for all of the protocols which I'm mentioning. Okay, he will be speaking to you a bit more on that later on. So the protocols, so I'll just try to give you some kind of an overview. So you have one of the protocol which is called as the Extensible Messaging and Presence Protocol, XMPP, and this is the one which is connecting over the text messages. And as you can see that the XMPP is running over TCP. Okay, the XMPP is a good way by which you can connect a home thermostat to a web server. You can see the details of this in the this which is given here. and you can see that how between the servers there is an optimized protocol which is taking place, and in effect that is trying to give you a connection from a XMPP client to another XMPP client. Okay, so then we have another protocol which is called as AMQP. This is called as the Advanced Messaging Queue Protocol. Okay, so here basically you can see that how the publisher subscriber concept is at play. So you have various publishers and they are connecting to the AMQP broker. And here they all connect to the exchange, and the various types of messages for the various subscribers, they are put into message queues. Okay, anyone who knows enough about the operating systems and all that, you also know that you have the inter-process communications also done at a OS level through message queues. They are serving the same purpose which is required here, that is the asynchronicity. So as you can see, the advanced message queuing protocol is going to send the data to the brokers, and from there the subscribers will be able to pick it up. And the AMQP middleware will be seeing that all the data is delivered. Okay, and you can see there are so many kinds of types of queues which would be there, and this is also is very much used in practice. Next, then we are seeing the MQTT protocol. So MQTT protocol is you can say very 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 much popular, and this is the MQTT standing for the message queue telemetry transport. Okay, so as the name says, telemetry transport, which is that is related to the instrumentation. So this protocol was developed by IBM, and it became as a lightweight publish subscribe messaging protocol. And the MQTT has a potential to support thousands of the remote users from the different locations through just one server. So now if you can see here, there, as you say, for different publishers and subscribers are shown. So basically you can see that how the protocol stack, that is MQTT, is built over TCP and IP. Okay, so that is being shown here. And the interchange of messages between any one publisher on the left-hand side to any one subscriber on the right-hand side is possible through the broker, which is there in the middle. And there is, you can see that there is a unidirectional flow of the information which is going from publisher to the subscriber. Now, MQTT would be, it's a standardization. It is therefore easy for the acceptance and adoption. And it is quite useful in the sense that healthcare, transportation, industrial control, energy and all those kind of things, wherever you have sensors on the objects and these are communicating with other systems or the applications. And it is ideal for the constrained networks, okay, where the connections are fragile, you have low bandwidths and high latency kind of situations. Okay, latency means delays, you know. So the bandwidths are low, so the communication will be perhaps slow. Okay, fragile communication connections, meaning that there are some windows in which there is no communication, some windows wherein there is a limited communication and things like that. And these are not, you know, you cannot make connections to a fixed schedule or something like that. Okay, so it is designed so that the remote objects with limited and constraints, etc., would be able to communicate properly. And that is shown in this kind of some references which are there. Several references are there. Okay, so that is the idea. Now, even with the MQTT, we are concerned that there should be a quality of service. Okay, so what we understand here by the quality of service is that there could be three types of quality of service, and they are given as a designations of QoS 0, 1, 2, wherein the QoS 0 is a fire and forget mechanism, in which basically the message is sent and then whoever sent the message is not worrying about it too much. and whether it reached or not reached and things like that. So in the next level of QS, it is slightly more sensitive, and it is trying to see that there should be a delivery, and it is trying to send the message number of times to see that, okay, maybe at least once that message should be received. Okay. And the last type is the one which is said to be more reliable. In networks, as we all know, reliability is brought in through acknowledgments. So if this has to be reliable, then the message is sent and the reception is acknowledged by the receiving node, which is the broker, and it is received exactly once. Okay. So this conference paper, you can see with this, where this kind of concepts were talked about. And of course, MQTT has certain advantages over HTTP, but MQTT advantages are quite good, that it is a simple and open kind of a model and uses the publish subscribe scenario. And there is a message persistence with the specific QoS. The message processing assumes that the device is not having too much of bandwidth or whatever, that the constrained kind of nature of the device is taken into account, and the data types, etc., can be decided, and you are having lots of details on the MQTT which is there. But in this time, I don't think so I'll be able to cover too much of that. So the MQTT application, we can see that how they are surrounding that. So you have automated metering, you have supply chain and the alerts and all these kind of things, which is set up. And then through that, the various application domains are set up. Okay, so this is what it would be. Okay, and actually, even with this, I don't think so that the problem is solved actually. Okay, so here again we are going out of the narrow domain of the protocols to understand that what is going on here. Okay, so we have to have QoS, and I'm trying to show you that in the context of things, where are the challenges and things which are there with respect to IoT. So we have the objects and the object communications, and then there is data. Okay, so what are the different types? So there may be that, you know, as you aggregate data over lots of sensors, then it may be a very large amount of data which is going to get gathered on. So that is relating to the big data and the cloud and those kind of issues. Okay, so that massive data kind of thing is possible. And as you know, as you are accumulating more data, then the issues are of the security and privacy. Okay, so that is, you know, how do you secure the data? How do you ensure the privacy of the data and things like that? And next level is that once you get to the communications, so then is there a scalability? Okay, because you are having billions of things, is it possible to scale up to that kind of a level? So those are the issues which would be there. And then here TCP is being shown, that is it the TCP is the best model which is there for the transport model for IoT domain? Okay, what would be the QoS which is there, which should be supplied? Should it be negotiated and things like that? Okay, what kind of architectures and where is the energy efficiency which could be there? Okay, and just from protocol point of view, that, you know, is MQTT the final one? How do we go with MQTT in a practical level, and how it is going to be taken up in a secure manner and efficient manner? So many challenges are remaining. If we go further, we see that there are heavy challenges to security in IoT. Because most of the components which are there in IoT are not monitored. Okay, meaning that you are deploying the elements somewhere, and after that you don't worry about what is happening to that. because they are generally very, very small and cheap devices. Okay, so there may be a physical attack on them. Okay, so that is one of the possibilities. As they are low, they are low capability devices. So we cannot run heavy security protocols, have heavy crypto kind of things, which will consume both energy and the computing resource. And as the most of the communications are over wireless, so then the eavesdropping, etc., will be taking place. Other aspect is like of the data challenge aspect, that is the amount of information which is there. So how do the protocols take care of what kind of data should be sent, how much of data should be sent, like that. So the transmission which is required, it should be transmitting, whether the data transmission can be taking place in the real time, or there is no guarantee of that the transmission is to take place in real time. Okay, so the real time versus non-real time applications is an important issue with respect to the IoT and the IoT resources. Then where is the data to be stored? Because as I said earlier, the resource constrained devices are there. It may not be possible to store those, the data being produced by those resource constrained devices. But then you need to have some kind of a trade-off which will take place between communication and storage. And so the storage also will consume energy, and whether where it should be stored, you need to get to the level, whether it is a fog or a cloud level, and there whether the data is worth storing at all, and those kind of issues has to be gone into that. And then the third aspect is that there is a trade-off between the processing of the data. So where the processing should take place. For example, suppose some of you have mentioned that, you know, you are interested in the computer vision related aspects of IoT devices. Now I may have cameras, and as you know, cameras can generate huge amounts of data if the resolution is high. But then what is the level of processing which is required? Suppose I have a camera, and the camera should be detecting that there is some intruder alert. Okay, how do we know that the intruder is actually a human being, or it is a false alarm because of some animal? Okay, so suppose you have a camera, it is processing the images, and then in those images, if I am running a processing element, the processing element is going to be able to decide that what it has seen in the images. Okay, so at a cost of the processing, you can have a much more higher quality kind of a service which could be delivered. Okay, so that kind of trade-offs are there, wherein capacity of processing of the elements comes into play. Okay, then the privacy challenges are also there, that the information provider is able to infer that. Okay, so if it is a personal data, that, you know, what is the protection for the personal data, and when should be that data be collected, and, you know, where it should be stored, or, you know, what kind of protection should be provided for that. Okay, so that is a privacy challenge. And then the standardization challenges are there, which is very much there. Okay, so the various vendors and those kind of people are there. They are into the many vendors will try to push their own kind of devices and all that. So for this reason, some alliances have been created. Okay, so there is a standard Zigbee alliance which is there, which is researching on the standard of the low power, low cost wireless technology. Similarly, there is a LoRaN alliance. Okay, LoRaN, okay, which is about that low power in the WAN. So LoRa alliance. Okay, so that I have not listed here, but that is also there as an alliance for the standardization. Okay, so Cisco is trying to, of course, come out with its own kind of things. which is called as IBSG. And whether whatever we are talking about security, is it able to scale up to the billions of the objects kind of thing? So there are so many problems which are there with respect to that. That is the scalability issue. Of course, that is there. As we know that how do we solve these kind of scalability problems in the internet is that, you know, whether the appropriate layers and hiding is able to take place, which is with respect to that. I think we have gone back. Not sure my cursor. Yeah, sorry. So I have mentioned that, you know, the transport layer protocols also has to be looked at, because if you use TCP, as you know, TCP is very resource heavy. The connection setups and all these kind of things are maybe not worth it for the transmission of this small amount of data. Okay, then, but TCP does have congestion control, and whether the in the wireless medium, whether it is possible to apply the congestion control kind of mechanisms which is there, and what kind of data buffering and things like that could be done for that. Okay, so yeah, that is the challenge with respect to the TCP. Okay, so I think I can, I'm concluding a bit early, roughly about 10 minutes early. So that some question, answer, discussion, or whatever, it can take place, and people are able to talk, and we can hear something which they wanted to say. Okay. So IoT is giving us a great many opportunities, and there's a huge scope for doing research and things like that. And MQTT is one of the critical protocols which is ideal for connection, interconnection of the physical world and the real networks. And we can say that the business integration of the protocols with the software or the middleware, which makes use of the publisher, servicer, publisher and publish-subscribe kind of architectures, is quite useful. Okay, with that I can stop. And we can just see some kind of applications which are there, where, you know, for supermarket applications with RFID sensors and things like that. So then what kind of energy consumption issues would be there with respect to that and things like that. Okay, so with that I can stop here. Okay, so if there are any discussions, questions, whatever, so we can take that into account. And of course, it is the organizer, I mean the organizers also will get enough time to be able to transition to the next program and activity. Okay, so with that I can stop here.
Sir, one of the participants typed a question in the chat box. Sir, may I read out, sir?
Yeah, yeah, better to read out.
Yes, sir. So Priya J is asking this question.
Okay.
Authentication and authorization are there for providing security? No, sir. Security, no. May I know in which layer this comes under? I repeat the question. Authentication and authorization are there providing security. May I know in which layer this comes under?
Okay. Yeah, yeah. So see, let me just go back and show the architecture which I had then. I think I stopped sharing. I'll share once again. Okay. So at the beginning, I have explained that where the security is so as you can see, security is a concern which is across all the layers. All right, so now authorization and such kind of things, you know, you can have authorization which is at a entry level into the network. Okay, so that is one way you can do that. Okay, then you can have a user verification, which is just before the service is going to be made use of. Okay, so that way you can have multiple reviews of the security credentials. Okay, I hope that answers the question.
Sir, may I proceed to the next question, sir?
Yeah, please.
So, Vandana, a question from Vandana Kushwaha. What should be better for research and development of protocols in IoT environment? Simulator or real test bed? So suggest some good simulators.
Okay. So, they want to know some good simulators. Okay, actually I had some slides which are related to NS2 and things like that. So NS2 is generally a very broad protocol which is there for simulation. But then there are so many simulators also which are there. Okay. What is happening these days is that there are we have shown that the low cost devices are available. All right. So the test beds with the low cost devices is these days proving to be a more important kind of a way for simulations, which are related to devices and the interactions with servers and the device to device kind of interactions. Okay. However, if you are thinking of very large level scenarios, basically if you are talking about a full fledged smart city with some hundreds and thousands of devices, we cannot have a test bed which is of that size. So at that level, then you have to better to go for a simulation. Okay, many simulators are there. As of now, perhaps I'm not able to mention those simulators. Many of the general purpose simulators, like GlomoSim and other such kind of sims which are there, they are all the simulators which are essentially network simulators, but then they have been adapted for the IoT kind of simulations. Okay, if you are just looking at the low level messages and the message simulations and all that, so for security also, NS2, NS3 kind of simulators, which are very broad level purpose simulators, they are also quite useful, but you have to customize the simulation to your specific point of research which you are trying to make. Okay, so that is what I'm saying for the if it is feasible to get 5-6 kind of physical devices, then you have a reasonably good level of test bed, and you can spend your time to try to make your protocol and deploy it on the test beds, on the devices, and you can get very good data. And I think so that will be giving more authenticity, because if you write a paper and you send it to a reviewer and all that, they are always having some doubts that, what was the simulation and whether that simulation has actually been done, and what is the authenticity, and so many parameters of the simulation we'll have to share and explain it and things like that. Okay, so
sir, a couple of questions are there. Sir, may I proceed to the next question, sir?
Yeah, please.
How AI can be used in IoT? There's a question from S. Jyoti.
Okay.
How AI can be used in IoT?
Okay. So we have AI in the form of that there is, you can implement a learning level which is on the constrained devices, and there are lots of references which is called as Tiny ML. You can Google for that also, TINY, Tiny ML. Okay, so this is the case where the ML is supposed to be taking place on the constrained devices. Okay, so that is a scope for AI at the level of the devices. Okay, but if you are thinking that there are number of devices and you want to learn in a distributed manner, which is across the devices. So then there are different types of models which are doing distributed learning. Okay, so the distributed ML aspects are there. So distributed machine learning aspects are also there. I think so one of the terms which is used, it is called as a federated learning. That is also the kind of terminology which is there. And definitely this is a emerging area of research nowadays.
So moving to the next question, sir, by Dr. Ajit. Dr. Ajit Kumar. So the question is, do you think there is a need of research to propose or develop new protocol to solve the challenges mentioned by you, or improving the existing protocol will be the research direction?
Okay.
I repeat the question, sir. Do you think there is a need of research? Do you think there is a need of research to propose or develop new? Do you think there is a need of research to propose or develop new protocol to solve challenges mentioned by you, or improving the existing protocol will be the research direction?
Okay. So if I understand that whether the present protocols are adequate. Okay, yes, so are the present protocols adequate to solve the problems? So mostly, you know, what they say is that in the industry, they say that if it is not broken, don't fix it. Okay, so that is what they say in the industry. That basically industry, they want stability. They don't want to go on experimenting with something which is new and like that. Okay, so the industry is looking at stability. Whereas what is also happening is that there are new kinds of things which are coming up. So for example, 5G is coming up. Okay, and the LTE and other such kind of physical layer things which are there. And then the 5G is also having higher layer kind of implications. So with the movement in technology, there is a natural change and development of the protocols which are existing. So what they do is they try to adapt the existing protocols with respect to those new technologies. So over a period of time, the somewhat incremental changes which will take place in some of the protocols will take place. Okay, so change will take place, and one has to see that and adapt for that.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, next question, sir.
Yeah.
So, hello, sir. I am a student of mathematics background. So, which area should I choose in IoT so that I can utilize knowledge?
Okay. So, I think for students of mathematics, their modeling and statistical aspects of the IoT protocols would be a useful aspect. No, so that is they may try to study at a queuing theory kind of a level, because as I have explained to you, that the message queues are there, and a mathematical model of the queuing and the efficiency, and that whether the timing and delays would be there, and that is one aspect where the person with the mathematical bent of training would be able to apply themselves, and they can also apply themselves like here this. The data processing aspects, the analytics which is there, which is related to IoT.
So, next question, sir. How IoT can be used for OCR system?
Okay.
IoT can be used for OCR system?
Okay. So, for OCR systems, cameras are always needed, because OCR is standing for optical character recognition. So, what they do is that you're having generally devices which are in the form of a handheld approach, and they are being used at various different places. Say for example, you are having a handheld device, and that is being used to look at some image. Okay, from that, suppose you don't know that language which is there on the board of that shop, so language OCR could be adopted, and then that will tell you that what it is, and these kind of things are coming up. The research of for this is still going on. Okay, if anyone has seen some videos of one person, mystery and sixth sense kind of things. Okay, that is a trying to show a future world wherein the OCR kind of adaptations will be there. See, static OCR meaning that a fixed OCR which is on the desktop or such kind of things, there the OCR challenges are already solved. What is required nowadays in the modern OCR is that whether from the handheld devices, you will be able to do a OCR and you'll be able to find out some information, which is, say, for example, dynamically useful. Okay, let me take up one example that we are going to think about the vehicles, which are autonomous vehicles. Okay, so one of the issues for an autonomous vehicle is that to be able to verify its location. Suppose for some reason the GPS or other such kind of things is not working, but the cameras of the vehicle are working fine. So they may be pointed towards the signboards of the shops and all that. And from there, the locality and that signboard information would be used to be able to verify the location with respect to the presence of the shop and their published address. And so that so this is a confirmation of the vehicle location. Okay, so these are some kind of applications, futuristic applications where research in OCR and these IoT systems could be useful.
Sir, last question, sir. Sir, could you please differentiate preserving privacy of consumer and authentication and suggest me some techniques also for the same?
Okay, the suggestion of techniques is not so easy because there are many things which are there, because basically it's not so easy because that, you know, you cannot use the standard crypto approaches would not be working well with the constrained devices which is there in the IoT systems. Okay, so what can be done is that certain type of low security encodings could be done. Say for example, there is a elliptic curve cryptography approaches. They are using less power as compared to the standard kind of secret sharing approaches which are there. Okay, so this is also proved. Some time back I had a PhD student, and there we have explored the session initiation and those kind of trust and other such kind of issues, everything which is based upon the cryptography of the elliptic curves and things like that. Okay, so that is one way in which the these things can be taking place. Okay, that is one way in which data can be sort of the privacy of the data can be conserved. Okay, so we need to know that privacy will be limited only. It is not going to be a foolproof or bulletproof kind of a privacy, because the computation required to compute a very heavy crypto approach is not possible.
So thank you very much, sir, for clarifying the doubts of the participants. May I now request the participants to give the feedback. I am just starting the poll. And another important request is, please don't leave the session. In the same session, I think we will have the practical sessions also. I repeat, please don't leave the session. The same session is going to be used for the next practical session. Before that, please give your feedback. I am just starting the poll. Thank you.
Okay. So should I leave? I can leave.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Wonderful knowledge sharing, sir. It shows up one from the questions the people were asking. They are very much interested and they want to discuss further more with you. I think because of the timing constraint, we are just moving forward.
Yes. So,
thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. It was great to speak to so many people. Thank you, Dr. Nagendra Kumar, for providing this opportunity. Okay. Goodbye.
Just 2 minutes.
I repeat the announcements. So those who have not given the feedback, they are requested to give the feedback. So 60% of the participants have given their feedback. The second important point, don't leave the session. The same session is going to be used for the practical demonstration. Thank you.
Good afternoon to one and all. I hope you completed the feedback session. So let us go with some practicals for the next 1 hour. So I hope you are able to see my screen. Srinivasan, I am proceeding with these practicals now. Shall I proceed?
Yes, sir. So, yes, sir. Your screen is visible, sir.
So we have shared with you the day one zip file. One folder has been shared yesterday and of course today morning also. So inside this day one, you have certain files here. Of course, the presentation slides, you please keep it aside for this practice. So the remaining folder contents are like this. So the first one is this particular. This is on the sessions that we have planned for you. So the day one practice session is consists of a demo on how to use Frizzy to design basic circuits with the Raspberry Pi, Arduino, or other set of boards, and demo on how to upload the schematics on Raspberry Pi simulator and run the program. And of course, how to connect the DHT sensor with the Raspberry Pi to collect temperature and humidity sensor with the Python program, and connect remotely to Raspberry Pi and see how this Python program runs and what is the output you're getting. And of course, the MQTT protocol demonstration with the Raspberry Pi. And of course, some practice programs are given to you to practice on the Raspberry Pi simulator. So the day one session is basically to morning. So far you have three sessions. So the first two sessions, we are basically concentrating on the sensors and the connections and the gadgets and so on and so forth. And the third session is on the protocol. The communication protocols or the internet protocols that are used in the IoT. So we have a small set of experiments covering those three sessions here. So for a beginner to understand how do we use the sensor and how do you connect with the Raspberry Pi, so we take with the help of a DHT, digital humidity and temperature sensor. DHT stands for digital humidity and temperature sensor. So we start with this digital humidity and temperature sensor. So on another camera, you can see. Just take the camera. Yeah. So you can see there is a breadboard, and of course you can see it on this. Is the ALAB window is open, Srinivasan? Srinivasan, Hello.
A lab window is open, sir.
Yeah, can you see that?
A lab window is open, sir.
Right, sir. Right. So,
yes, sir. DHT 11 specifications.
Yes. So you can see there are two screens actually. One is one camera is fixed to the sensor board, and another screen you can see the specifications of this digital humidity and temperature 11, which can be connected to your Raspberry Pi. So if you see any sensors, they definitely before you use the sensor, our advice is to please read the data sheet of that particular sensor. Usually the data sheet provides the complete specifications on how to use the sensor and what are the constraints and the limitations of the sensor and so on and so forth. So here we have a DHT 11 sensor. So you can see this is basically a 4-pin, but the 4th pin is not been used. So that 4-pin device is internally requires 4.7K to 10K resistor, which is already placed in between pin 1 and pin 2 inside this particular sensor. So this is a digital sensor in the sense that it sends the analog values, and that analog values are converted internally, and you get out from the sensor is a digital set of values that can be connected as to the input to the particular GPIO pins of your Raspberry Pi. So on the figure, if you see, there are 3 pins. One is a plus, another is a minus, your cathode and anode, and the middle leg of this sensor is basically your out. That's what your V out is coming from this particular sensor. And this sensor requires a V in, the V in of 3.3 volts. So that is what, and of course the ground is not going to be used here, it's going to be connected to the ground of your Raspberry Pi GPIO pin. So here we are going to show the real connection on the camera here. So yeah. So our student Ajit will now show the connections here. This is. Can you show the pins and connections? So there is a breadboard here. So on the breadboard, we just placed the DHT sensor. Take out and keep it inside. DHT sensor. So yeah. Continue. So this is a DHT sensor. You can see it there. It's not coming. No. It is coming. Now you place it. Keep it there, Baba. Be first. Leave it. So this is a DHT sensor. Yes, you can see the 3 pins. Now we are connecting this to DHT sensor, and we are placing this on the Raspberry. Before connecting to the Raspberry Pi, we are placing it on the breadboard. So this is, So once we place your DHT sensor on the breadboard, so we'll take the jumper wise. So the jumper wise we are taking, because there are 3 pins, you need to have 3 jumper wise. Now, you can see it on my screen. The Raspberry Pi pin diagram. So this is a Raspberry Pi pin diagram. You have the 40 pins of Raspberry Pi. So the 40 pins of Raspberry Pi can be used to connect your digital sensor. So here, we are connecting pin number 39. Pin number 40 and pin number 1. So here, camera. Camera, you can use the camera, sir. Hirima Sam?
Yes, sir.
Can you please pin the AI lab?
Sir, actually, I have pinned, sir. That should be done by each and every participant. That is what I'm about to say. Participants are requested to pin the AI lab window so that you can see the window in the maximum size.
Yeah. Yes.
So I request the participants to pin the AI lab window.
It is not coming, Srinivas, it seems.
Sir, I have pinned, sir.
Okay. Anyway, just once you make the connections here.
Sir, a few participants are saying like, yes, they responded. Yes, we did. It's coming. So
okay.
I request the participants who have not pinned. So many participants are saying, yes, it is coming. People who are new to Zoom, they can explore. They can find the AI lab window. And you can click on it and you can pin it.
We have connected the positive of your DHT sensor to the 3.3 volts of the Raspberry Pi.
Sir, could you please stop sharing the screen, sir?
Yeah. Is it okay, sir, now?
Yes, sir. So they are asking, like, please once again show, sir. So
yeah.
Some participants are saying, yeah. The participants are asking.
Put the camera there, sir.
To show the connections again.
So this is a DHT sensor, just placed on the breadboard. Yeah, continue. So yeah, so the positive of your DHT sensor is connected to 3.3 volts. So here we are using the jumper wires.
So they are asking to tell the pin number also, sir.
Yeah, pin number of Raspberry Pi 1. So pin number of Raspberry Pi 1. And the negative is connected to the ground pin 39. And the output of this is connected to the pin number 21, GPIO 21. So these are the three connections which we have done. And just show this. So, and we have placed the, show that now. And we have placed this particular thing here on the table. This Raspberry Pi remotely from your place. So I request any one participant to access this now. I'll tell the steps to access. Other participants, please do not try. If everybody tries at the same time, then it will be a clumsy and we will not connect it properly. So I will ask anyone who is interested, please raise your hands, please.
So participants are interested, participants can raise the hand.
So only any one participant. I will make you the host and you please perform the steps on your own to connect and see the output of that.
Interested participant can raise their hand. So Priya J raised hand, sir.
Yeah, Priya J, sir, please make her the host once, please, so that I can redirect her. ma'am, can you please share your screen? Priya J, ma'am, can you are you able to share your screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please share your screen, ma'am. I'll tell the steps to be performed. So we just play. You connected the Raspberry Pi and we powered on, and there now you can access from your desktop. Okay. So please go to the browser, Google Chrome. Yes, please go to the browser, Google Chrome. Yeah. Please type the URL web dot. I have entered into the chat window. Please type that particular URL. Web dot. Yeah, Wild Radiant Studio. Wild Radiant dot studio. It is in the yes. While you no, spelling is wrong, ma'am.
WY, madam. WY.
Please copy from the chat, ma'am.
I can't take from chat, sir.
Yeah, please copy from the chat window.
There is a spelling mistake, madam. WYLIO.
Got it.
Yeah, so
what to do, sir, next?
Hello, Priya ma'am.
Yes, sir. What to do?
Yeah, please. Now you select a create a new application.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, create a new application.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, create a new application. Press 1 second and select the Python. See, please, all of you, please follow this screen here carefully. Python, please select the Python option.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, and give a project name.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, create project.
Yes, sir.
Right. Please select the demo now.
Yes, sir.
Please now exit here. There is a window
here. Okay, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Please select. You have received no option. Please click no. Yes.
Yes, sir. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Now go to the menu option, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Please select session ID.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now you remove this session ID, whatever it is existing over there.
Yes, sir.
And please. I have pasted one session ID on the chat window.
I'm seeing, sir. I haven't get it.
Yeah, I already pasted, ma'am. Just see here.
Okay, sir.
Please copy and paste it there, ma'am.
Okay, sir.
1 second, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, there is another, yes, please click yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now you see here, there is a green bar is coming, authenticated to WebSocket device. It means you are connected to the cloud now with that session. Sir. So please click connect button now.
Okay, sir.
Now you see, there are two Raspberry Pis here, SCIS Pi 1 and SCIS Pi 6.
Yes, sir.
These are two Raspberry Pis which are available in our lab now.
Okay, sir.
The temperature sensor and the humidity sensor is connected to Raspberry Pi number 1.
Okay, so, sir.
Please select Raspberry SES Pi 1.
Okay, sir.
Yes. Now, once you select here, you can see there is on the top, your menu has been changed now here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now, one second, ma'am. Don't go. Please, hold on.
Okay, sir.
Now, in the application window, you have to write a code.
Okay, sir.
What code you have to write is, yesterday I have sent one zip file for you. Have you downloaded it, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Can you please open the Python file, a small Python program I have given to you in that zip file?
1 minute, sir.
You have not extracted that file, ma'am?
I had, or 1 minute, sir, I'll take.
Yeah.
Sir, in that?
Yes, you please open that day one, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
So in this one, yeah, practice one. There is a zip file there. One more zip file is there, yes.
Yes, sir.
Please open that main.py.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, just double click, it will open. Open with a notepad. Just open with a notepad. No problem. You'll have a notepad over there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please click the notepad. Yes. So yes, please, please copy this code as it is, this 4 lines code.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please copy and paste it in that application now.
1 minute, sir.
You are in the another window. Next tab.
Yeah. I can't get this.
Yeah, next to the downloads window only, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please press enter there. Okay, remove it. Okay, press enter now. Yeah, paste it there. Now you please run this. There is a run in the menu. Yes, just below that one.
1 minute, sir. This one.
Yes, run. Now you see the temperature and humidity of our room, of our lab, you are able to see the values over there now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you are remotely connected. Now, to the participants, just let me explain this small program here. So, this is a Python program which you are interfacing to you that temperature and humidity sensor. So, in this Python program, one library is there. That library is basically Adafruit, the Adafruit company. They have prepared these libraries. So, in that, you have imported that library here. And once that library is imported, since we are using DHT11 sensor, that sensor is been accessed as a object. So DHT11 is basically an object which has been now taken into your local variable called sensor. So the variable, local variable sensor is equal to Adafruit DHT. So that object is calling that DHT11 sensor function. And the output of the temperature sensor is connected to GPIO pin, that is pin number 21. So we just mentioned the pin is equal to 21. And we have simply written a loop statement here to continuously print the humidity and temperature. This is basically a Python statement, print statement itself here. So basically, this is how you can connect directly to a Raspberry, means your temperature sensor, and you can try to monitor it. Of course, here in this example, so you understood what is a sensor is. It consists of basically sensing the environmental values, that is the temperature and humidity from this environment. And that sensor is now, is basically converting into the digital value, and the digital value has been sent as an input to your Raspberry Pi GPIO pin. And of course, because you are now not physically present here, so actually if you are physically present here, you should have shown and you can directly demonstrate the hands-on. Since you are now virtually located at a different place, so we have made a provision to remotely connect to our Raspberry Pi, and you can see the temperature and the humidity values here. See, language incompatible error, please do not change, because only one Raspberry Pi can be connected at one session only, please. If multiple sessions are being made use of, then everybody tries on their own and you cannot see the outputs properly. Everybody tries their own program. So we configured only for one session at a time. So madam is now disconnected.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, somebody else is now trying to connect here. That is the problem. I request the participants, kindly bear on with us. One by one, you can do it. We will give some time for you. It will be on only throughout this night. So you can access whenever you are free, you can access and you can try and write the Python program, so on, you can try and so on and so forth. Okay, this is one experiment which we planned. Okay, let's, madam, you need know, you can just go to the other experiment now. So those who are not having or those who cannot connect to this Raspberry Pi, we have a simulator here. So let me connect to a simulator and show. Sir, ma'am, you please disconnect now.
Okay, sir.
Your stop video of yours.
Okay.
So I am sharing my screen now, please. So this is basically your DHT sensor, the demo of this, and you practically you connected and seen that one. So let us now see the simulator. So you can, I hope you are able to see my screen, please.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
you could see your screen, sir.
Yeah, now we are connecting to a Wild Redeem Studio only, the same cloud-based IDE. So at one, this is one platform where it provides several options for you. You can play with simulator, you can play with the emulator, you can directly remotely connect to your Raspberry Pis. I request the other participants kindly bear with me. Kindly do not connect to this session IDs, please, now.
Sir, there is a request from the participants to go a bit slow because they are the first timers.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll give the, there is a time for you now to understand. Don't worry. So just hold on. Sorry for that. So let me just go with the simulator first. So simulator here, if you don't want to connect physically to a Raspberry Pi, means remotely or physically, you can have a simulator option is there on. You can see here, there is a simulator option here. Raspberry Pi, Raspberry Simulator. So please click the Raspberry Pi Simulator. So once you click the Raspberry Pi Simulator, instead of working directly on the Raspberry Pi, you can also as well practice on this simulator for your learning purpose. That is the power to use this Raspberry Pi as a simulator. Before you go to the Raspberry Pi simulator, let me tell you how to bring a circuit or how do you put your sensor to your circuit with the Raspberry Pi or the Arduino. So yesterday I have shared with you a software called as Fridging. So there is a folder, your day one zip file. Under the day one zip file, you have a Fridging software. So that Fridging 0.9.3b.zip file. Once you extract this zip file, you will find a folder with the name Fridging itself, where if it is a 32-bit PC or if it is a 64-bit PC. I'm demonstrating it. Please look onto my presentation, please. So Fridging, as of my system is 64-bit version, I'm selecting the Fridging 64-bit. Okay. So here under the 64-bit version, you have an exe file here. So just double click this exe file. Of course, it is not extracted, extra tall. Once you extract the files, you will see the .exe file, which will enable you to open your application. So most of the experiments, before they actually do on the real systems, people do a little bit of practice on the simulators and emulators. And for this to run on the simulator and emulator, you need to have a software like Fridging or Proteus. For electronics and instrumentation guys, they know what is a Proteus is. For a beginner, like a computer science person and all, Fridging can be easily adaptable and it can be easily understandable. So people can prefer this one. So I'll just keep it that for a side for time being. So once you extract that one, Fridging, you will get an option like this. So Fridging.exe. Just double click that Fridging.exe. So the application starts So whatever the software I have given is basically a beta version. So you do not worry about the copyrights. So they have given for the testing purpose and it is free to use. So the one which I shared to you, it can be free to use. So this is what, once you open the freezing, your screen looks like this. This is the landing screen once you open the application. So on the right side, you can see various electronic parts, the core parts, including the resistors, the LEDs, the sensors, the actuators, the ICs, and so on and so forth. So if you can scroll down a little bit further, you'll see the microcontrollers, which are basically your Raspberry Pis, the Arduino Unos, and your computers. The computers are your basically your Raspberry Pis. So you can see all these things. So before, what we are trying to do is, we are trying to use these components and prepare our own circuit, prepare our own branch, prepare our own model for our execution purpose. So what I do is go to file, new. So you are going to prepare a new sketch, a new circuit diagram. So once you click the new, you'll see your breadboard. So for a beginner, always please remember, you need to understand what a breadboard is. So this will, breadboard is a kind of a gadget which will help you to interconnect various components here. So the principle here is, this is one type of breadboard where you need to follow certain indentations, and in other terms, you need to understand the usage of this particular breadboard. So this is a large size breadboard. So you can see a small holes are there here. So these holes are basically vertical. So when, in whichever hole you're going to put your pins of that particular sensor and all, so the vertically connected holes, you have been highlighted with yellow color. It means if you put a pin over there, in it, from this highlighted yellow holes, you can even collect that particular value, or you can give as an input also. And at the outside, at the boundary side, you see another set of holes. So basically, if you click on any of that particular hole, you can see all yellow lines have been shown. It means all those pins are being interconnected with each other, and they all function in the same way, and they are meant for the same purpose. So any particular hole in that horizontal line at the boundaries are one and the same. So if you look to the second row, it's the same thing. So if you, again, once again, I'm repeating, the holes in this vertical pins or vertical holes that you see is all have the same functionality, the same values will be there for the input as well as for the output. So you need to be careful here whenever you're interconnecting this. So this is basically a vertical breadboard here. If you want a different set of breadboard, you can move to the side screen, and you can see on the right side, you can select the size of the breadboard which you want it. So I'm selecting it half plus. So this is a small breadboard now. It has been in the half size. So you have a limited set of holes which are to be connected. So depending on your application, you can use the appropriate breadboard for you. So this is basically your big one. And if you want a small one, you can as well select the small one here. Right. So once you selected this, now see, I'm selecting an LED here now. You just select the LED, select it and drag it here. And you can see the two legs of this LED, which are being placed onto the two holes. So the two holes adjacent to each other are being highlighted in the green color. So it means it is being placed correctly. So all the holes in this vertical direction have the same outputs which are being, or the inputs of the particular pin, which we are making use of an output, it will be an output. If you're making it as an input, it will be considered as input. So no other legs of another instrument should be connected on these vertical green lines. So you need to be very careful here.
Sir, a couple of questions in the chat box. Would you take them now, or we'll take the questions next?
Let me just complete this and I'll come back once again.
Sure, sir.
Okay, now similarly, you can take the Raspberry Pi here from the computer section. So you can just simply drag the Raspberry Pi over here onto your sketch. And of course, if you want to be connecting this GPIO pins of your Raspberry Pi to this LED, you can just select the Raspberry Pi and you can rotate it. And I'm just rotating, I'm setting the values from the right side. You click it, it will rotate it. And see, you can place your mouse pointer on this Raspberry Pi. So you can place your mouse pointer on the Raspberry Pi and you can see what are the pins numbers are there. So basically I selected a ground pin here. Similarly, now this is GPIO 11, pin number 11. And here there's another pin here, pin number 10. So similarly, you can see the 3.3 volts. So I request all of you, after the session is end, you can explore what are all the pins here. Those even those who are not having Raspberry Pis, you can at least understand the GPIO pins which are available on this one and see. So here, this is what your pin number one is, which is been 3.3 volts. This is pin number two, this is 5 volts. And this is pin number 39, ground, pin number 40, GPIO 21. Actually, this is the pin which you have connected your temperature output in the real, in the real scenario. So you can use here, similarly, you can bring your Arduino boards. So this is the Arduino board. You can as well as integrate or interface with your Arduino boards. So here also, this Arduino board also has got your analog pins. If this is what analog in, you can see A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. And these are the power pins. You have a digital pins on the other side of the Arduino board. And as well as other set of digital pins and the reference voltages. Like this, you can see there are pins which are available. Everybody can try to understand what are the pins available. If a beginner is there, please understand these things without buying these devices. Right. Now, we have given you a tutorial here. So if you want to connect, now you can select this one. And of course, if you want a resistor, yes, you can also have a resistor here. So you can select a resistor here. I'm just selecting a resistor, you can see here. So this resistor is R1 and this resistor is basically 220 ohms. You can see the resistance on the bottom of my screen, it is clearly given 220 ohms. So what type of resistance, how much quantity of resistance you want, you can select that particular resistance from this particular schematic, from this sketch, and you can place it here. So you can place your resistor properly connected to that particular pins. So once it is connected, it shows green colors lights or green color highlight has been highlighted on this vertical holes. It means all the holes have been connected. It means this particular resistor leg is properly connected to that hole. That is the indication for you. If it is a green color, it comes. Then you can as well connect this particular resistor to this and connect a wire like this. You can bring a wire. You can connect it to any of the GPIO pins, GPIO, so you can select it, click the particular pin, drag it. And if you want to provide a connection, you can directly provide, you can provide a neat connection also. So I don't want to waste much time in these connections. You can play around with this and to have a proper schematic, you can do all this kind of stuff. So once you do this one, please remember, if you think your schematic is correct and perfect, please, I'm just showing how to save these files. So you can click the save as. First, I'm giving this name to a sketch file. This is something like demo 2. This is a sketch file demo 2. That's what demo 2.fzz. Fzz indicates a freezing file. Now you please export. This is the important thing that you need to look for. Once you prepared your schematic and it is correct, you need to look for export. So export as an image, and you need to select SVG format. So you save that particular .svg files at a particular location. Once you exported that, yes. Similarly, one more export is required here. That is what your XML netlist file. The XML values for this demo 2, you can save it at that same location where you have saved your .svg file. So once this .xml and your SVG files are there once your schematic is done and once you obtain those exports. So now you can go to your while reading studio. You can go to your while reading studio and you can go to the Raspberry Pi simulator. See here, already the Raspberry Pi simulator. Once I click the Raspberry simulator on the menu bar, I come to this particular point. Now there is a load schema. So already there are existing tutorials are there, 3 LEDs, 5 LEDs, LCDs and all. But since you have designed your own, you can select the load schema. So the load schema will ask you to import your SVG file. So go to that SVG file where you have stored. Somewhere I have missed the path of this one where I stored this SVG. Just hold on, I'll trace it back. The documents frizzy. So here I have this demo2bb.svg file. So I'm importing that SVG file here. So this is what your SVG file has been imported. Similarly, I want how to import the XML file. That is what your demo2netlist.xml file. Click open. So you have imported your SVG file and your, of course, the connection is not complete. That's why it's saying your circuit is not complete here in this case. So I'm assuming that still it's to be uploaded. Yes, you can upload. So this is what it has been uploaded onto my while reading studio, onto my Raspberry Pi. Of course, this circuit is not completed. It will not run. But this is the way you need to upload here. So what I request you all is, we have already given you the sample tutorials for you to work it out in the today's evening or before the tomorrow morning session. So what we suggest you is, you also please request to practice these sessions at your own pace or at your own speed, and you can try to understand them and you can ask us the queries if you have it in the tomorrow's session. So in the day one, you have this particular simulator practice 3. This is what you are, I have given you the screen prints also, whatever I explained to you. The screen prints are shared to you, the freezing screen prints. After extracting the file, creating the new file, these are all the screen prints I already shared to you with 4 LEDs, how to interconnect and all. So please go through that practice step by step. And you try to export in the form of SVG file as well as in the XML format, and you try to import it. So these are in the practice 2 sessions. This is given to you as a tutorial 1. Then after that, you can also practice this practice 3, simulator LED patterns. So once you import it onto your while reading studio, you are going to select the simulator, and like this you can. So here, the program which you are going to run on the simulator is basically a JavaScript program. So the JavaScript program, Python, you are not going to have this option at this present, at this moment. So the small JavaScript program is given to you. So if you're interfacing with your GPIO pins, the same like your C programming, you are going to hash include, you're also including onoff.gpio. This is a library. So in this, there is an LED program. LED should be on and off, which is connected to pin number 4 as an output. So you are writing that LED write sync 0. It means you are making that pin to be a low value, the off value. Similarly, that you are putting a time frame here and you are running that So the status of the blink, status 0 and status 1. So for certain time, you are going to on and off the switch. So this is how you are going to get the output here. With simple LED here, you can try it. You can run the same program at your own place. Just write, instead of Python, you have to write the JavaScript here for this simulator space. So this exercise, we are expecting you to complete. There's another program here, so you can try to practice at least as many programs as you can. All these programs are already executed and they have been tested by our students. So you can also, those who are beginners in this particular connections of LEDs and with Raspberry Pis, so please do practice here. Let us complete this session by tomorrow. So this is the work we are giving for you. The homework is given to you so that you can practice. This is on the simulator. So now another experiment which we like to show here is on the MQTT protocol that we discussed in the third session. So we have completed the DHT sensor connecting to the things and LEDs. So this practice on the simulator LED buttons and buttons as well as LEDs, please practice on your Raspberry Pi simulator, the steps which are given to you. And if you have any doubts, you can discuss us in the tomorrow's practice session too. So still we have 4 days, time is there. You can practice on your own. Until unless you don't do on your own, you will not get some confidence. So please practice that one. So let us now have an understanding on practice on usage of MQTT protocol. So now we are connecting to another Raspberry Pi, which is physically located in our lab. So that Raspberry Pi is number is SCIS Pi 6. So I am trying to connect this Wildwood in studio again. I'm coming out of the simulator now. So once again, I'm going back to web.wildradian.studio. Beta version, no. See, here I'm getting a server error. It means I'm not connected to the cloud server. So would you like to use Studio here? Yes. So once I get the green color, it means I am now connected to this Studio. And once I connected to Studio, now I can access my Raspberry Pi. So I'm accessing the another Raspberry Pi here, SCIS Pi 6. One of my student is helping me here, Ajit. So. Should I click? Yes, so I'm clicking the SCIS Pi 6 and there's, I'm going to the now shell prompt. See, now I'm remotely connected to this. So this particular Raspberry Pi, as you have understood in the theory session, see one camera is already posted onto the screen. You can see there is one window. I am also connecting. This is simultaneously connecting the Raspberry Pi. So there are two command prompts here. So what you understood in the MQTT, MQTT is a one Internet of Things network protocol, which usually follows a publish subscribe model. Already you have seen in the last session, what is publishing? Publishing means basically any entity is trying to put some data onto the broker. Here broker is a term which is usually used in the MQTT protocol. Basically, broker is like an intermediary person which is acting like a server. So anything that any device, any IoT device, like your DHT sensor. DHT sensor is going to give the humidity and temperature sensor. So it is going to publish so that another entity, like your AC control or your another room conditioning control device. So room conditioning, like your AC device, wants to know what is the current room temperature. So that automatically that room temperature and the humidity values are being collected from the temperature sensor, which publishes onto a server. And from that server, the room controlling device, it can be any electronic or electromechanical device, which is connected with each other, this DHT sensor and that electromechanical device, she'll collect the data, she'll subscribe the data. So you publish and subscribe. Publish is like a producer, subscribe is like a consumer. So it is like a producer-consumer problem. One person produces, the other person consumes it. So in between producer and consumer, you have an intermediary, a buffer, or a queue, which keeps maintaining those particular transmission of messages from one entity to another entity. So this MQTT is a lightweight, basically. At the same time, it has got its own limitations as far as the security is concerned. So we have installed this MQTT protocol on the Raspberry Pi. So the installation steps and everything is given in the tutorial. So in the tutorial session, if you go to our zip file, what you are given, in that we are given, how did we install the Mosquito? That is a Mosquito software, which installs the MQTT protocol to have publish and subscribe steps. So now what I do is, we have installed our Mosquito server as well as the PAHO Mosquito client. So the client is one particular application. The server is basically the broker. So that is what Mosquito broker. So here, we will run and show you the demo of how do we run the MQTT protocol. We publish something to a particular topic. The topic name here is test. So I publish something onto the test topic, and there is a subscriber. The other student is there on the other side. So he is going to subscribe it. So to run this MQTT protocol, I am issuing some commands here. So publish. So Mosquito. Underscore pub. Mosquito underscore pub indicates I'm trying to publish one particular data onto a particular topic. So the port number we have already configured. We have a little bit of security. We have put our communication is happening under the port number 1883. And the username is Pi. The password for this user is NAGPI99. And the topic name, that is hyphens T small t, the topic name is test. To this topic, I am giving a message that is small f is giving a message like this, message message one. So this message one is basically, it can be a sensor value, but for you to understand this protocol mechanism, exchange mechanism, you just put a simple message here. So now I'm just press enter. It has already come there on the subscribe model. So if you see it on the other camera, so I am keep on sending the data now here. Instead of message one, I will send some other data here. Message 1, 2, 3, 4, something like this. So you can see this is 11 bytes message. The number of characters have been already been sent to that many number of characters on the subscribe. So basically, Mosquito pub implies you're publishing a particular quantity of information using the Mosquito server. So Mosquito servers gets this particular topic information. More in the last session, you understood what is the server, what is the topic, and what is this public subscribe model. Just here we are demo, given a small demo to exchange the data between these two, these two entities, publisher and the subscribe model. So this also you can practice it. These two Raspberry Pis will be on tonight. Anyone who is having certain free time, you can as well practice on this. So now I'll take up the questions, please. Hello, Srinivasa.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. May I read out the question, sir? Or
Yeah. Please.
So the first question is,
which menu I have to select to give your cloud connect to give your cloud. This is like posted long back, sir, when you are trying to connect to the cloud. Actually, which menu I have to select in the IDE to connect to the cloud?
The session ID already I have shared it, so one person can access at a time place the session ID which has been shared to you. So the, anyway, the systems will be on tonight. My suggestion is, first please practice the simulators. The steps are given there, so please do practice the simulators first. Once you are confident with the simulators, then you please come to the real practice scenario of connecting the devices.
So we can also do same with Arduino and Tinkercad simulation. We can also do same with Arduino and Tinkercad.
Yes,
so she might be referring simulation.
Yes, if you say the Arduino and Tinkercad, you can also use it for the simulation purpose. You can use it. How to know the
session general ID? Question, whatever.
The session ID, that's what, the session ID is actually a password. That's what we, the password for this. So we, actually we, I should not share with all of you, but this is a practice session only. So it has been shared to you all. So only do cooperate among yourself, because there are 100 plus participants are there.
So yes, only sir, one another question is like, sir, language incompatible error coming. That was a recent question. The reason is like multiple participants are trying to connect using different languages. That could be the answer, sir. Am I correct, sir?
That's what, if you see, the device is only one thing here. Only one device is there here. It is not doing multitasking. It is not a multiple operating system is there here. It is a Raspberry Pi and a Raspbian operating system. So basically, machine entities can talk to each other with your application logic, but the accessing and modifying the things cannot be done, because it is just a device, a small device, which is meant for to do a certain machine task. From tomorrow onwards, can you please increase demo? Yes, definitely. I will do that one, because tomorrow third session is mine only. So I will stop explaining more and try to do demo things more in the tomorrow session. Tomorrow that I will do it, because third session is mine only. After half an hour or the maximum 40 minutes, I will stop and we'll proceed for 2 hours demo session tomorrow. Not only demo, you have to practice it. In fact, I will ask any one of the participants to execute it. So today, like one participant was asked to execute direct on his own. So only thing is this, make sure that at least you can do it on your own. That is the purpose only there.
How to connect to SCI Spy 1, please show once again.
Yeah. So let me, I think my screen is shared to you all.
No, sir. Now it's.
Yeah, 1 second, I'll share it. If anybody is connected to SCI Spy 1, please exit it. Somebody else is using there. Now I am connected, yes. So usually the first step is I'm closing the browser here. 1 second, I'm opening the browser. See on the browser URL, web.wildradium.studio. Please click this particular web address. Already we have given the steps to you, it seems here. If you please look into the tutorial, please first. So all the steps are there in the stepwise. So once you come to this, this is basically a cloud studio platform. Beta version, please do not select the beta version. You may lose your scripting course. So make sure you are entering the session ID here. So the session ID, this is one passcode which you have created. And we have already placed this passcode on the Raspberry Pis. So this is the passcode. Once you enter the passcode, click connect. Yes, by one connecting. He connected. There only. Somebody might have pressed the disconnect option. 1 second, please let me tell you. Once you connect it, something like this. Please do not disconnect it. This is a disconnect button is there. If you disconnect the, you are disconnecting the Raspberry Pi, and the Raspberry Pi mode will be in shutdown mode. So please do not disconnect. Do not click this disconnect. Next to disconnect, we have a button called exit. please exit the application. That's all. You don't disconnect because Raspberry Pi is already connected to this application here. So that is one request here. So just click the exit button instead of disconnect. Yeah, once you, I am just like my exit. Once you exit here, again, you can go back. And the faculty, since you are most of the faculty people, you can also set up your own laboratory things and people can work remotely here. So you can also do this kind of stuff. So as of today, we have seen Raspberry Pi simulator and the real Raspberry Pi to be connected. I will talk to you in the later stage about the emulator, which is more advantageous than simulator. So SES Pi 1 is here. So click the SES Pi 1. Once you click the SES Pi 1, you can see the menu, all the options are there here. These are all the menu options. Yeah, this is the already the program is there, the Python program. So I'm just running the Python program once again. You can see at the bottom of my screen, temperature 25 degrees centigrade, humidity 45%. Of course, this is not accurate values. There are plus or minus. You please refer to the data sheet of that particular sensor. You will get the what is the plus or minus values for the sensor. Usually, temperature will be plus or minus 2 degrees and humidity will be around plus or minus 5. Please. Any other doubts, please? Of course, today is very exhaustive for you all. You have been attending since morning. So far, I can see around 104 participants. So just I request you all to practice this simulator. First, please practice the simulators, simple LEDs and buttons. Our students have prepared those tutorials. If they missed any point, I can clarify you. So please practice those simulators. It is available to you. Even if your Raspberry Pi, somebody is disconnected, don't worry. We will connect it tomorrow again. And the fourth day, we'll give you enough time for you to practice also. Okay, of course, tomorrow onwards, the different sessions are there. It's not just simply sensors. We'll go for tomorrow, the cloud computing, the edge computing, and TensorFlow Lite, deploying TensorFlow Lite for image processing on the Raspberry Pi. That is what your machine learning techniques, how we can run machine learning techniques on the Raspberry Pi. That's what tomorrow's session is highlights, sir. Please do attend tomorrow's sessions, please. Do not miss. Yeah.
There are other couple of questions, sir. May I read out, sir?
Yes. One second.
Yeah.
The software is, yes, the Wildroutine Studio is open source software, please. It is an open source software. It is a free. In fact, you can download the software and run your software on your own system in the Linux or in your Windows. That is fine.
So how to use FreeSync with Ubuntu? I searched the website, but it seems paid.
Sorry?
How to use FreeSync with Ubuntu? Searched the website, but how to use FreeSync with FreeSync. Ubuntu?
Yeah. Can you hear me, Senior sir?
Yes, sir.
The FreeSync software already I given to you all. It is a software. I am repeating once again, please. See, the FreeSync software which is given to you is in a zip file. This is actually the main 3.7 MB file is there. Sorry, 370 MB file is there, this one.
Yes, sir.
Now, you please unzip this file. Once you unzip this file, you will get this particular folder. Of course, can you see my screen, Srinivasa?
Sir,
Oh, sorry.
No, sir, no.
One second, hold on. I'm just sharing my screen, please. The folder which I have given you yesterday, day one zip, it contains the FreeSync software as well. You need not download, you need not buy, you need not search for anything on the net. Already the software is downloaded and it is given you in the form of a zip file.
Sir, please, is it Windows version or Ubuntu or both?
It is a Windows version.
He's asking like how to use FreeSync with Ubuntu, like that he's asking.
You can create a virtual box. In fact, our student has done on the virtual box itself. Create a virtual box and you can run that on the Windows operating system. So once you extract that FreeSync zip folder, you will see that 32-bit PC or 64-bit PC. and you will see this freezing.exe file. Of course, Ubuntu version is also there, but I do not have the software at present me. I cannot share that one. In fact, it is already installed in me, in my system. Yeah. Any other doubts, please?
So they're asking for resources, sir, PPTs and recorded versions.
Already the presentation one and presentation two you are given. I will ask Professor Atul Negi, sir, to give the session three. So hopefully by tomorrow morning, I'll share that one. As well as tonight, you will get the day two materials for the practice for tomorrow sessions. Tonight, I will post it, please. And today's third session, I will request Professor Atul Negi, sir, already mentioned in the presentation. Sir is going to share with me the papers as well as the slides. So that's of that particular copy is also there. Any other doubts, please?
1 hour demo practice session is not enough. That is the opinion of one of the participants.
Demo practice session, yes, we want, but we cannot give the complete day. Already the Raspberry Pis are open to you all. You can practice it now. Only to don't disconnect it. Okay, please. Yes, dear. Definitely, it is a good thing that you are showing interest in that practice. Yes, definitely. The another 3 days are there. For 4 days, time is there. Another 4 days. So anytime, whenever you are free, you can. Yes, we are.
The next question is: what is the difference between a simulator and emulator? Thank you.
Very good. Very good question. See, emulator is the one which is actually the original thing that is going to happen for you. In the sense, whatever the things, the original thing is, the real thing is doing, it will emulate it in the sense that it will try to do the same thing. Whereas simulator, it has its own limitations. It can only do certain things only. It will cannot do all the things that the real thing can do. So that is the thing. That is one of the major difference. As far as the Raspberry Pi is concerned, if you see the market last 4 or 5 years, many people have tried to develop emulators. So those emulators are there. I will show you 3-4 emulators on the last day, but not all emulators are full-fledged emulators of Raspberry Pi. You can do a minimal Python programming and very minimal things, but doing the artificial intelligence and machine learning things has to be done on the real Raspberry Pis. A few of them can be done on the emulators too. So an emulator is one which can do most of the functionalities what the real thing is going to do for you. Whereas simulator doesn't do all the things. It has its own limitations.
So another question, sir. With one Raspberry Pi, how many devices can be interfaced?
See, the general purpose GPIO, if you are seeing the is a 40 pin, except your ground pins, all other pins can be used for your the way you cascade it, the way you design the system. Basically, we have went up to only 6 systems, in fact, in the experimental and for our research purposes. So, but in theory, it all depends on the design when you connect your different set of sensors, in what way you are connecting, whether you're connecting serially, whether you're connecting parallelly. So you have something called SPI, already mentioned, serial peripheral interface, and I2C. So using these two buses, you can have the master slave configuration to have many multiple devices to function in parallel to the data place.
So next question, when we move a device IoT enabled, what are the issues?
Sorry,
when we move a device IoT enabled, what are the issues?
When we design, I did not get your question.
When we move a device IoT enabled, so what are the devices? What are the issues? What are the issues?
Issues for what?
So when we move a device IoT enabled, what are the issues? So she might be referring that, I think, when we in the IoT environment, mobility will be there basically.
Mobility.
She might be referring mobility.
Now mobility, yes.
Addressing.
Yes, see here, basically, if you are having a common communication medium, wireless communication medium, when I say common communication medium, is something like a ZigBee or a Wi-Fi, or your if you take very micro level Bluetooth itself, or if you are taking the LoRaWAN, if all the devices are connected in the same communication medium and they are following the same set of protocols for exchange of data, there is no problem in moving the device from one location to another location. A simple example, in a smartphone, if you put a sensor in one room and if you move the sensor to another room, and if the smartphone is having the same communication media and same communication protocols are being followed, there is no problem issue at all. Until unless if you are moving outside the range of that particular communication capabilities. So that's what the wireless communication, the networking aspects comes into picture. If you are having only Bluetooth connectivity, then obviously the range, the frequencies, the data rate, the sampling rate, all these issues will come into picture, please. So basically, whenever you deploy a IoT system, always a compatible, heterogeneous kind of sensing systems which are been deployed in a particular place, the smart building or a smart home. So you have to make sure the communication media, the protocols, the networking infrastructure, how they are being made use of, so that even if one device fails or one device moves from one particular GPS coordinates to another GPS coordinates, if they're on the same communication media, networking protocols, there's no problem. Whereas if there are different communication philosophies from one layer to another layer or from one subnet to another subnet, then there is the issues for you.
Last two questions, sir. Where can I select Raspberry Pi in while you're drinking, sir?
Raspberry
Pi. Can I select?
You mean to
where
say
can I select Raspberry Pi? Yes, sir. In while you're drinking.
I think is my screen shared, sir. Is my screen shared?
No. Yes, sir. Now, sir. Yes, sir.
Here, this is a web version. This WildRoutine Studio also has got a software. If you want to have practice the simulator, you can as well download the software for Windows or Ubuntu or your Mac or any operating system. You can as well download the software and run it. You need not have the web connection also. So once you go to their website, WildRoutine.com, you please see the website. I'm just showing it on my screen. Download WildRoutine Studio 2.3.1. So it can be Windows, Linux, Ubuntu, Mac OS, they're all there. But one suggestion I will give you, don't download the software from this website. They have their GitHub. I know the guy who is working on this. His name is Alexandru. So I'm already in touch with that guy. So he told me that please download the software from GitHub rather than from this .com website. So you can search it on the GitHub. So you can download the appropriate version, the latest version, the stable versions, of course, and you can install it. Of course, for Linux and Ubuntu, there is no installation. For Windows, you need to install the Node.js servers and accordingly the other software set requirements are there, dependencies are there. For Ubuntu, just at a click of that particular downloaded app application, you can run this file. It's no problem. And so once you, if you are using the web version, so web.wildroutine.studio, you can go to connect. And in the connect, you'll see Raspberry Pi simulator. Just click the Raspberry Pi simulator. So this is just a simulator. It's not a real. The real Pis are here, SCIS Pi 1 and SCIS Pi 6. They are now the real Raspberry Pis which are available in our lab. Tomorrow, you'll see other set of Raspberry Pis, 3, 4, 5. They're meant for different applications. That will demonstrate it tomorrow. For those people who want to practice, you can practice the Raspberry Pi simulator. So on and so forth. Yeah, any other doubts, please?
So I am getting a module not found error, sir. That is module not found error. Maybe. We may need the context also, sir, where they are getting.
The module not found error is basically meant for the packages are not installed. The packages are, if you want to install the packages on your system, see like this, of course, I have not given the complete details of this since I thought you'll do the practice first. So the package, if you can see my screen, the screen, if you see here, the packages are listed here, the package manager. So these are already packages which have been installed. Please check these packages. I am using the Raspberry Pi GPIO pins here, please. That's why this rpi.gpio is already installed. So tomorrow you will see the TensorFlow and other set of packages for other applications. So in this DHT, we have used the Adafruit DHT that is also been used here. So you can install these packages and you make sure that you are going to run here. So just try it. Of course, all doubts or all things cannot be done at this hour or at this instance of time. You do it slowly. Don't worry. Don't be hurry. Please go through those well-written studio website itself. You will find a lot of information. So of course, we are sharing our knowledge and experience. But so tomorrow, day after tomorrow, you have a lot of time. So we'll discuss it together, please. Yeah. Any other doubts, please?
Last question, sir. How to generate session ID?
Session ID is the secret passcode. I'll tell you the procedure. Don't worry. Because if I tell now, you'll start implementing and you'll completely mess the existing ones. That's why I'll definitely, that's my promise. On the fourth day, I'll just definitely tell you how the passcode is generated for you. Of course, if you search their website, you'll get that information. But anyway, I'll try to definitely I'll give that information to you on the fourth day, the last day of the practice. Yeah. Any other doubts, please?
So that same person is saying like I have Raspberry Pi board, so that's why I ask.
So who is that? Actually, I'm not saying.
So he's Jameer.
Jameer Sheikh. I'm promising you, I'll tell you that installation takes a lot of time. And I will tell the procedure for you and how to generate the passcode. It's basically you have to flash the information onto the Raspberry Pi flash drive. That installation process, either myself or my students will tell you, don't worry about that. We will do that one. But today, on last day, we'll tell you the procedure. Any other doubts, please?
Yes, sir. I'm done with the questions from the chat box, sir.
Yeah. Please. And also, I'm just ending my video session from here. If you want, you connect the feedback, or otherwise, you'll wind up the session. And tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock, we'll meet with the other sessions, please, as per the schedule. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Please take care of yourself. See you tomorrow. Thank you.
So, dear participants, the links to the sessions are given in the schedule. Of course, we would resend the links through WhatsApp group as well as group mail also. So we will follow the schedule and we'll please attend the sessions as per the schedule. Thank you.